Okay, hey, what we're gonna do today is I thought I'd shoot a video about some tone work, and that's where I take a drawing like this and fill it with some gray tones. So I'll be doing things like this whole sky area, which is right now just white. I'm gonna put some cool cloud cover in there and have to decide which way the sun is coming from, so either this side or this side of this building are going to be in shadow. That's what we're gonna do. This is the problem we're solving today. So what I've done is I've taken this drawing and I've prepped it. It's all solid line work. It's just crisp black and white lines. It's going nice and tight, and you can see what I'm talking about. So if we get in really, really close, let's get the, there we go. Yeah, you can sort of see the stepping here of, oh yeah, we're tight in the pixels. Look at that. So, and you see this kind of mistake here? This sort of thing, it's almost impossible to see that from, you know, at the printing size, but let's clean that up, get that edge nice and tight. Yeah, actually, sometimes you have like lines that are part of the background here, and they sort of look like they overshoot the boundary of an object, but really what I have is that's part of this detail, but it sort of lines up. And in real life, like when you look at a photograph, that sort of thing happens all the time, and you just assume that it looks right because you're looking at a photograph, so clearly it's an accurate representation of reality. But in a piece of artwork, when the same thing happens, it's less acceptable because people think, oh, that's a mistake. Well, even though it's just an optical illusion, or it's an optical result of two objects happening to line up, it's best to sort of, I find, just nudge them and just say, you know, send the viewer into the correct direction, even though it may not be 100% accurate. Like in a photograph, I could have gotten away with that. In a piece of artwork, you want to pull a little bit higher than reality would normally allow. And then I have little things like this where I've got like a white outline. What is that part of? Let's zoom out a bit. Yeah, sometimes you have like the background not 100% lining up, but it's such a small thing, like no one's going to be able to see that, so I'm not going to worry. And sometimes it's okay to sort of, you know, illuminate an object by cutting the background off immediately around it. It pulls attention into the image or into the piece a bit better. But I've more or less taken care of all of those problems. I've gone over this with a fine-tooth comb, and I figured out I've gotten it to a point where I'm happy with the line work. So the line work's done. I'm not gonna spend any more time noodling over that. Today's job is toning. So let's start off. Should we start with the sky? I don't know. Well, the sky is not gonna change, you know, based on the position of the sun. It's gonna be, I want the sky to be quite bright. So whatever clouds and such I put into here are gonna look, they'll be influenced by the shapes. Like if I go with a really dark shape here, I might want to do something different with the sky later on. But now let's do the sky. Let's do this. And we're going to use the magic wand tool, because I think most of my objects here are closed off, and it's just a quick way of selecting everything, and it looks like it's done a pretty good job. And there's another little bit of sky here, so you hold down your shift key and that adds. So now I've got this selected area and this selected area, and like just as a demonstration, that's not bad. Now, we're not going to do that. Now, here's one little spot in the selection that you might want to look at. I've got these little objects in the background here. Now, they're bits of the little bits of building mechanics on top of this structure, and they've been selected along with the sky, and I don't want that. So we're going to, whoops, you hold down the Alt key, and now it's subtractive selection. So now anything I deselect is going to be free of my toning influence. Let's do that. Let's just do a quick little check around the corners here. Yeah, it looks all right. Whoa, hang on. Let's go a bit tighter. Okay. we can, oh, there's a little spot here. Because this is, there's sort of like this this railing that kind of goes along the top of this building. And it's wrought iron, and it's got like a nice shape to it. And there's little spots where you can see right through it. I'm going to leave, I'm going to let that selection stand. I think that's pretty good. Because, but here's a problem. This little piece of the building here has also been selected, so we want to get rid of that. I don't want that to be part of the sky. So again, we do subtractive selection. And go, let's just freehand along here and just make sure that none of my, and this is selected for when we do the clouds. And there we go. Now it's all out. And everything in here looks good. I think we can do a sky. Now, there's lots of ways of doing a sky. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to first save this. Let's see, selection. You can save the selection. So if I want to come back and fiddle with the sky after I think it's done, but want to reselect the area, I don't want to have to go through the selection process again. That was a pretty quick selection process. We were really able to use the magic wand, but we're just going to go sky. There we go. Now that's saved for later. So if I need to reselect it, you know, I can. Now, this is just basic nuts and bolts of Photoshop. It's not that interesting, but that's part of the process of selecting. Selecting is half of tone work, you know. It's, you know, you wanna make sure the area that you're working on is not going to be affecting any other area. You want to be able to like, let's get a really big brush here. I'll show you what I'm talking about. So that's pretty useful, you know. You don't have to like go right up to the edge and hope to not, you know, damage the rest of your line work. You can just be quite carefree, and that's kind of neat actually. You could probably put like a dinosaur in the background. Let's Alright, whatever. Okay, enough messing around. So for skies, what I like to do is you got to know the time of day, and this is sort of, it's maybe 3 o'clock in the afternoon, which is actually going to cause a bit of a problem. I was thinking a bit about this, because this is when Tammy's, you know, school's been let out, so it's like 3:15, it's probably around quarter to 4 at this point, because she's been walking around a bit, and that means the sun is going to be in a particular part of the air. Like, this street is going north-south. And because we're going for historical accuracy in this scene, you know, I'm kind of locked to cardinal points on a map, like compass points. And so north is this way, south is that way, and that means east is here, and west is that way. And so the sun is going to be somewhere over here, which unfortunately for this picture means that this building is going to be all in shadow, and that so this whole front here is in shadow. So these are going to be two very dark shapes, which isn't exactly a pleasing thing after you've spent all this time, you know, nailing down detail and whatnot. But there's a trick that I can, there are tricks that the illustrators know, so I can be accurate in terms of where the light is and yet still get a pleasing effect that doesn't wipe out all my detail. And we'll get into that a bit later, but we're going to start with the sky. And what you do is you pick I like to do the atmosphere, pretend there's no clouds, and just let's see here. Yeah, kind of get like a light blue effect. Now this is in black and white, but I think in terms of the color. And along the horizon, it tends to glow a little bit more. And as you look further into the sky, if you turn your camera up, the top takes on this darker hue. It's still illuminative, like, you know, the whole thing's glowing. The sky, aren't skies amazing? Are we lucky to live on this planet? The sky is like this marvelous, beautiful color, and the way it treats light is just magical, right? But I'm going to go a little, I'm just going to experiment a bit, because the undo function is so easy. Ooh, that's kind of neat, but not quite what we're after. It doesn't hurt to play a little bit. Just sort of see. I think my first one was pretty good. So yeah, we're gonna go with that. So that's the basic. Hang on, you can noodle forever. Okay, so that's the basic sky. It has an gee whiz. Let's do this. What was my first one? It was about like that. I want to get a little bit more glowy near the horizon. Wow, you can get some really different effects from how the sky colors, because we live under it all the time, right? So we have a certain immediate instinctive impression of the mood of the planet just based on a few visual keys and where the sky is and where the sun is. We pick up on that stuff. So, and speaking of sun, you see this little thing in the corner here? That's the sun from my window creeping in. So let's try and get this done before it obliterates the image. I do have a cloth up there, but covering my window, but we'll see how far we get. Anyway, so that's the base. Now, what I often will do is when I'm just hammering out panels and I need to get things done quickly, I will use the burn and the dodge tool. And right now I've got it set to midtones, and let's see. And let's see, is that doing things? Can you tell? Yeah, you can sort of tell. So you can just quickly drop in sort of sky effects. You know, make some clouds. And those look all right. That looks pretty cool, actually. But I don't want to do that for this. Oh, gee whiz, I'm going to save that because that looks really... That might just be useful. So we're going to edit, copy, and paste, and just turn that off. So if I mess it up, I can bring that back if I need to. So anyway, let's see here. And yeah. So let's bring back that selection. My selected area has been undone for some reason. I don't know why it does that, but that's why you save it. So we load the selection and we go sky. Bam, there we are again. And I have my function keys set so I can just crank, you know, get rid of the gray immediately. Anything that's not black is gone. So we can start again. So let's do that. Whoops. So what I have in mind now is there are these cool things you can do. I want to get a little bit more detailed in what I'm going to do with the sky. I am going to do a little bit of that dodge. You know, just to put a little bit of variance in there, because there's several layers in a sky. You've got low-lying clouds and then clouds that are much, much higher up, and it's sort of, you get this multiple swirling effect as they move in front of one another. So I'm just going to add a few little details like that. Then, what I want to do is use an actual paintbrush, and I'm going to go in with, I don't know, let's say like a 10%. That's fine. Let's go around a 10% gray. And I'm going to give myself a bigger brush, and it's going to be an airbrush. Does that work? And we're going to go normal. The opacity we're going to put at 100. Is that working? Yeah, it is. Okay. I'm going to go a little darker. Let's go like this. Make the brush a bit bigger. Don't like that. Let's go for white. 100% white. Go to the tops of clouds. There we go. Now, this way, not unlike the dodge and the burn, you're adding another layer of detail on top. In fact, why don't we do that? That makes a lot of sense. We have Photoshop, and it works. Its superpower is that it thinks in layers. So we're going to add some layers. Here we go. This is going to be my cloud layer. And this way, I can add some clouds, and if I don't like them, it's not a tragedy, because I can turn it on and off. There we go. Now, I'm actually going to... Yeah. Let's see here. I want to get the impression of... the clouds spreading overhead. So if it's like a massive shape that's above that you're looking up through, as opposed to doing it thinking in terms of two dimensions, and just sort of making a cloud layer in the background, which is an easy effect and it looks pretty cool, but I want to have it kind of coming a little bit off the camera here. And this is neat. You can just sort of, it's very organic clouds. You can just sort of play around and sort of see what your hand does and be very, very loose with it. And if you don't like it, well, it took you 2 seconds to get there. You can always undo, just or try again with another one. So this is one of these days where the clouds are a little bit fluffier. And I like this little spot here. That's kind of like glowing a little bit. I don't know if you can see that in the video, but you'll have like these sort of areas of highlight. So there we have some basic, oh, that looks neat. Let's do this. For a big shot like this, like that's a half page panel. So it's an important shot, and it's okay to get dramatic with that. You don't want to make it boring, and skies can have very dramatic shapes that lead the eye. And so we're going to make sort of a swirl sort of effect from above. Just do that. So all these sort of clouds from above are going to be sort of leading to this point and kind of coming out. Cloud painting. Now I could use a cloud brush. I'm not that good at using the different brush types. I always just use an airbrush and can kind of construct my own shapes. But man, if you go online, you can find whole libraries of very extensively created cloud brushes, or you know, brushes of different types and textures. And I didn't really know what a brush was. Like, I think of a brush as, you know, a paintbrush. But in Photoshop and in art program speak, a brush is you know, it covers a much greater, the definition covers a great, you know, like a larger area of meaning. And so what a cloud brush would be is like someone would, you know, paint a beautiful cloud, take a sample of the entire cloud, and call that the brush. So when you drop it down, it makes, you know, another impression. Is, and you can drag your stylus across the screen, it'll make copies of that. And you can set it so that it'll tilt it in different ways, or flip it, or make them bigger and smaller. And so you get many, many copies of that same cloud, but there you can like sort of paint with cloud imprints. It's kind of neat, and you can get some very, very cool effects. So that's what, you know, it's kind of like a car brush. So I could like take a sample of this car and just paint and have like 20 different cars suddenly just, you know, appear under my stylus. And so I'm painting with cars, you know, like, okay. I still think in terms of, you know, the real world in terms of a brush is, you know, stick with bristles and you can manipulate to basic shapes. So what I'm going to do now, let's zoom in a touch, is one of the cool things you can do with a big brush is lay down these general shapes. But if you take a little tiny brush, then you can get those little wispy sort of edges. You can get very sort of tight details, because clouds have defined shape. And so you're just kind of like poke in around here. Can you see that? You can catch those little wispy sort of edges that clouds have. There we go. And that's with a little fine brush, so you can just sort of add the details around the edges. And this gives me a great deal of power over what I want to do. And I don't want to go overboard with this. Just want to have a few, you want to make a few areas where when the eye sees it, it recognizes me, oh yeah, yeah, you know, it's a cloud with a defined edge. But you don't have to do every single square inch of detail. You just pop a few details in here and there to give that impression, which is enough. Because if you go overboard, it'll actually change the overall feel of the painting, or of the, you know, the image that you're trying to get. And I want to keep a certain mood, so that might just be enough. Now, I'm not 100% certain about this area here. I think that looks a little that, it kind of looks like everything's coming up. I want it to sort of move more this way. Yeah, I'm not 100% happy with that. So let's try some deformations here. We've got, let's transform this. Free transformations, yes. So a free transformation means I can shrink and enlarge. Okay, I'm gonna escape that, bring it back to normal. And I wanna make sure that when we're doing the transformation, and I may not go with this, that it's not, that it's gonna do it in a smooth way. So bilinear is good. That's the option up here, you can't see that. Man, you can see that sunlight beginning to come in here, eh? Anyways, so it's doing a bilinear transformation, which means that it will smooth the edges of things as they enlarge and shrink. Like if I were to do a transformation of this building edge here and do the same thing, then the lines would get fuzzy, they'd lose definition, you don't want that. But for something like in the background that is meant to be made of gas, that's a good way of going. So what I want to do is I want to bring this set of details in a bit. So I'm gonna, that's not it. Okay, there's a different kind of transformation. Let's go free transform, distort, that's what we're after. Distort will let me do this kind of thing. That's what we're going for here. And there we go. That might be enough. Let's see what that looks like. Select. Does that look a bit better? Let's undo that. I think it looks better. I might come in here and do a little bit more. Let's go select, reload that selection again. Man, that, good, glad I saved that selection. And you see how, when we go in really, really tight, how the clouds have sort of come over my borders? I don't want that. So I'm gonna invert the selection so it, you know, now everything on the outside is selected, and I'm gonna delete it. So, bam. So all those bits of cloud that were falling outside the image are no longer there. But I'm not liking these little things here. It looks like sort of smoke tails coming out of the building. So I'm gonna go in there with my brush again and just sort of make those a little bit, take out some of the definition there. There! I think that's pretty good. Maybe I'll just, let's undo this. That's much closer to what I'm after. That's not a bad cloudy afternoon there. That's how you do. So there's a good sky. All right, this is quite a long video at this point, so I'm going to cut this off and cut it together with maybe some other stuff. So I'll show you those other bits later. All right, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in another video. All right, cheers.